Hello everyone. In the last session, we have seen design of displays. Now we will deal with design of controls. For that, we will first see what are the controls. So controls are the devices through which a man or a user conveys his instructions to the machine. So controls are the devices through which a man conveys his instructions to the machine. So there are various types of controls which are used in the machines. I have listed some of them, like cranks, hand wheels, star wheels, knobs, hand levers, foot pedals, push buttons, toggle switches, joysticks. So these are some of the controls which I have listed out. And generally controls are used for controlling the machine, or I will say giving some instructions to the machines. So we'll see first one, crank. So all of you might be knowing that this is nothing but a figure of a crank. You can see here. So the cranks are used for providing the torque by hand. We are going to operate this by means of hand, and we can use the crank for providing the torque. Generally, the small cranks up to about 100 mm length are used for fast controls and providing low operating torques. Means the cranks are having length up to 100 mm. They are generally used for fast controls, but they are providing the low operating torques. While larger cranks are used, they will provide slow controls, but they are providing high operating torques, right? So generally what it take away, if the crank is small, then it can be used for a fast controls, but it is having low operating torque. When you are using the large crank for slow operations, then the operations will be slow, and those large cranks will be providing the high operating torques. Hand wheels. This is a hand wheel, you can see here. So generally hand wheels are used for circular controls at low speeds by hands. Generally these are used for low speeds, and these are controlled by means of hands. They are suitable for low to medium operating loads generally, and the hand wheels should have the diameter in the range of 300 mm to 360 mm. So this diameter should be in the range of 300 to 360 mm, and these are used for low to medium duty applications. Okay. Next one is a star wheel. This is the figure of a star wheel, and star wheels are used for circular controls at low and medium speeds by hands. These are used for circular controls at low and medium speed by means of hands, and they are suitable for medium to heavy duty loads or medium to heavy duty applications. The star wheels are used. The next control is a knobs. Okay, so already we are knowing the figures, or from figure you will come to know what exactly the knob is. So the rotating knobs are used for circular controls at low speeds. Either we can operate it by means of two or three fingers, or sometimes we can operate by means of whole hand. Then small sizes knob, which are having diameter up to 10 mm, are used for light duty applications where the speed of adjustment is required and the coarse adjustment is permitted. Okay, whenever we don't want a fine adjustment, coarse adjustment is permitted, at that time we will be using the small size knobs which are having diameter up to 10 mm, and obviously we are going to operate them by means of fingers only because they will be having a smaller size. Medium size knobs, they are having the diameters in the range of 35 mm to 50 mm, and these are used for light operating loads where fine adjustment is required. Because the size of the knob has been increased a bit, so we can go for a fine adjustment because we will have a better grip, and due to that we can go for fine adjustment, and these are also operated by means of fingers. This is the information regarding medium size knobs. And for large size knobs having diameter 50 to 70 mm are used for medium loads or medium duty application where step-by-step adjustment is required. Okay, and these are operated by whole hand. Okay, so as size is larger, so we can use our whole hand for operating this. Next is the hand lever. This is the figure of a hand lever. So hand levers are used as a fast, fine, and one-dimensional control for large operating loads. Okay, so these are used for fast, fine, and one-dimensional control for large operating loads. So it can operate only in one dimension, like this only. Means if this is a lever, we can move only like this. Foot pedal. So here I have shown the figures regarding foot pedal. So generally, this angle is 30 degree with respect to the crown level, the angle of inclination of foot pedal with respect to horizontal line. It is approximately 30 degree, and here we are pivoting the heel, and here by means of our fingers, foot fingers, we are going to operate this particular pedal. Foot pedals operating loads are used for fast controls, for medium to large operating loads. These are used for faster controls, and it will be used in medium and large operating loads. The pedals are operated in the seated position by using whole leg or by pivoting the foot at the heel. Okay, so here we can pivot our heel, and by means of foot we can operate this, and this angle is around 30 degree with respect to horizontal. Push buttons. So these are the figures of push buttons. We already we can see this everywhere. And push buttons are used as light load only for on off controls, and these are normally designed for operation by means of one finger. The diameter of one finger push button should not be less than 12 mm, so at least it should have a diameter of 12 mm. And we can operate it by means of one finger only. Sometimes large capacity push buttons are used for operation by means of which we have to operate those push buttons by whole hand, but those are used for large capacity. Okay, so the large capacity push buttons are designed for operation by the whole hand. Toggle switches. Next is control is. So these are the figures for toggle switches. So toggle switches are used for light, used as a tight load on off controls. It should have a minimum length of 12 mm and angular movement of 45 degrees. This minimum length should be of 12 mm, minimum length. It could be more than that, but minimum length is 12 mm and the angle of movement is 45 degree. Joysticks. Most of us are familiar with this. Sometimes we have also used it while playing the video games. So joysticks are used for fast, coarse, and simultaneous two-dimensional control for operating loads. So for two-dimensional control means what? We can move this particular joystick in this direction as well as in this direction, and also along these directions. So we can move in two directions. So it is having a two-dimensional control. So joysticks are used as a fast, coarse, and simultaneous two-dimensional controls for light operating loads. They are used in the computers and CNC machines. Now our next point of discussion is ergonomic considerations in the design of controls. Means while designing or positioning the controls, what ergonomic aspect we have to consider, that we will discuss one by one. The first one is the control should be easily accessible and logically located or logically placed. Okay, so we have to arrange or place the control in such a way that they should be logically located as well as they should be easily accessible to the person who is working on that particular machine. The operations should consume minimum energy. If we design and position control in such a way that it should consume the minimum energy, so that the most of the energy of the person who is working on the machine will be utilized in working only. It should not invest in control operations. So we have to take care that we should position the controls in such a way that it should consume the minimum amount of energy of worker. Again, proper colors should be used for the control devices and the background so as to give the required psychological effect. Means what? You are designing the control, so for as far as color combination is concerned, we have to use the proper colors and also a proper color to the control devices and also to the background, so that it is giving a psychological effect to the worker who is working on that particular machine. For example, the control should be painted with a red color, in a red color with gray background of machine tool for attention. Means it should catch the attention of the worker who is working on that particular machine. So this is one of the example that has been given, that control should be painted in a red color with gray background of machine tool for attention. The control operation should involve minimum motion, right? So we have to position the controls in such a way that it should create the minimum motion of the worker. Means what? It should be logically placed. Now the next point is compatibility in the design of control members. So we have seen the control members, what are those. Now we will discuss about compatibility in the design of control members. So what is compatibility? So compatibility is the state of conformation between the environmental inputs to the individual and resulting responses. Okay, so we are providing environmental input to the individual and the resulting responses from the individual. The state of conformation between them is nothing but the compatibility. Compatibility in the design of displays and controls facilitates the performance and reduces the human errors. Okay, so if we'll imbibe this compatibility in the design of displays as well as controls, it will improve the performance and it will reduce the human errors. Compatibility refers to the relationship between display signals, control responses and also the expectations of the operator. So it is the relation between the display signals, control responses and expectations of the operator. So according to the interaction between display and controller in the human machine interface, the compatibility can be divided into several categories, right? So it is the interaction between what? Display and the controller in the human machine interface. The compatibility can be divided into several categories, but the most common two categories are as follows. First one is called as a spatial compatibility and movement compatibility. So what is spatial compatibility? The spatial compatibility refers to the correlation among the physical arrangement of the control and associated displays in the space. Okay, what is that relation between physical arrangement of control and their associated displays in the space? So that is called as a spatial compatibility. So here we have to just see on the physical arrangement of the controls and the displays associated in this space. So examples are the layout relationship between control switch and the cook top on the gas stove. Okay, so we are using gas stove. So there are controls below that, and again we can see the display, I won't say, but I will get actually what exactly happening on the gas stove. Again, operation panel of a CNC machine. Okay, we do have control panels, control knobs with us, and also At the same time, we can see exactly what the CNC machine is doing. Cockpit control of room of an aircraft. So see here, we do have controls as well as displays there. Again, control panel room of an automated factory, elevator panel and floor number. Means just like a lift, there are operation panel like close the door, open the door, like light on, light off. Again, we have to press the floor numbers, etc. So it is also nothing but the spatial compatibility, because there is a physical arrangement of controls and their associated displays. Control device on the vehicle dashboard, like suppose there is a music player, then if you at all you want to turn, then it is indicating on, off, whether you have to play the USB mode or aux mode, or you have to just enjoy the songs through FM. So there are controls, and according to that the displays are placed there only. So means it is nothing but a relation between the physical arrangement of the control and the associated displays in the space. It is called as a spatial compatibility. Now we will see what is the movement compatibility. Movement compatibility refers to the relationship between control motions and the movement of display indicators. See here, what is that relation between control motions and the movement of display indicators? Means what? While operating the control, people have always certain expectations about the relationship between movement of controls and movement of display indicators. So it is something there in the mind of the people that there has to be some relationship between controls and movement of displays. Just like I am having in my hand a bolt and a nut, and if I am going to rotate the nut clockwise, then it will move forward, okay, and the assembly will get tightened. And if I am going to rotate the nut in the anti-clockwise direction, it will get again dismantled. Means I am going to rotate in the clockwise direction, it indicates that we are fitting the component. If I am rotating the nut in the anti-clockwise direction, it indicates that I am dismantling the component. So this is kind of a expectation is there about movement of controls and movement of display indicators as far as movement compatibility is concerned. So example, okay, see here, clockwise rotation of a control knob for a fan is expected to produce an increase in the fin of this fan. Okay, a clockwise rotation of a control knob for a fan is expected to produce an increase in speed of the fan. Means if I am going to rotate the knob of the fan in a clockwise direction, so it is expected that the speed of the fan is going to increase, and if I am going to rotate in the anti-clockwise direction, the speed of the fan is going to decrease, right? So it is an expectation about relationship between movement of control and movement of display. So we have listed out some of them, like movement of controls and movement of display indicators. Okay, if control movement of control is in the upward direction, so what is the movement of display like? It will open or it will get on, it will start or it will have on the higher speed, or it will increase. And suppose a movement is on the downward direction, so it will off the machine or it will stop the machine, or it will reduce the speed, it will decrease the speed, or it will close. Again, clockwise means what? Movement of control is clockwise, then movement of display indicators will be either it will get on or it will go on increasing. Clockwise means what? Again, sometimes turn right or move right. Anti-clockwise means what? Opposite to that of this. So it will be off, movement of display will be either off or decrease. So I think initially, right now there are some of the fans, control of the fans that we are using in our residence. So at that time, assume that the fan is in the off condition. So I am going to rotate in the clockwise direction, it will get on, then it will move on to the speed 1, 2, 3, 4 like this. If I am rotating them in the clockwise direction, and suppose I am going to rotate them in the anti-clockwise direction, so that the speed will decrease from 4, 3, 2, 1 and it will get off, right? So this is how the relationship between the movement of the controls and movement of the display indicators. Now, the most important parameter is design of environment and safety. So, working environment generally affects significantly the man-machine relationship. Even though there is a very good relation between man and machine, but the working environment, if it is not good, then it will affect the efficiency, health, safety, and performance of the operator. Okay. So, the most important factors affecting his or worker's efficiency are, right, heat, humidity, light, environment, noise, accelerations, including vibrations. So, the factors which will affect or which will reduce the performance of the workers are like, suppose the, there is a heat, humidity is not proper, humidity is on the higher side, light is improper, air movement is not much, there is a lot of noise, and there is acceleration including vibration. So due to that, the performance of or efficiency of the worker will get affected. Now we will concentrate on these factors. Like factors affecting the working efficiency are lightning, noise, temperature, humidity, and air circulation. Okay. So suppose what happens, like if there is no sufficient light. What I am saying, if there is no sufficient light. So generally, most of the time, the person or a man depends upon the sunlight. But whenever you are, I will say that there is a cloudy sky, and due to that there will be insufficient light. So at that time, what you have to do? We have to just provide the artificial light so that the worker will work properly. Noise. So what exactly the noise is? What noise? Noise is defined as the unwanted sound, and it has been shown to have both short and long term effect on the human performance. Okay. So noise itself is an unwanted sound, means we don't want to hear that. Okay. And the noise is having some short term and long term effects on the human performance. Okay. Noise may cause fatigue or irritation, and due to that there will be reduction in the productivity, and it will also prone to some accidents. Okay. Next is the temperature. Suppose if there is the temperature is too high. Okay. So what will happen? Due to that, the worker will not feel comfortable while he is working. So he will not be able to give his best, and due to that, production rate will get reduced. And also there has to have a proper humidity and air circulation, right? So if we'll concentrate on these factors, then anyhow we can minimize the minimize the factors which will control the workers in productiveness, right? If we'll keep them in a proper manner, it will be easy for the worker to work in that particular conditions, and his performance will anyhow get increased. So for that, there has to be some ideal working conditions. So what are the ideal working conditions that we will see now? So as far as temperature is concerned, it should be around the range of 18 degrees Celsius to 23 degrees Celsius. But again, this is depending upon the season in which they are working, means whether it is a summer season, winter season, or any season. Apart from that, what type of cloth they wear and what type of industry it is. Suppose it is a cold storage industry, then requirement that of the temperatures are different. If it is a foundry which the person are working, then the requirements of the temperature may be different. Relative humidity. What is the ideal range? Ideal range is around 30% to 70% of the humidity. And as far as light is concerned, at the daytime there might be sufficient sunlight available, but if you are working on a shop floor, there has to be some artificial light, and the illumination level has to be better than 200 lux. Means lighting intensity on the floor per meter square. that should be the intensity which is required, and that will be the ideal condition as far as light is concerned. Now ventilation. Ventilation means what? The rate of airflow will be or has to be 6.6 meter cube per hour at sea level per person and light work. Right? So this is the standard rate of air circulation, 6.6 meter cube per hour at sea level per person and at light work. Noise level. So already we have discussed that if there is a too much of noise, it will prone to the accident, it will irritate a person, and due to that there has to be some long term and short term effects on the performance. So noise level should not be more than 10 decibels. Still there is a lot of noise, then how we are going to minimize it? So for that we can use the noise absorbers, or we can provide the earplugs if at all there is a noise. So also we have to think about the improving the workplace layout, right? And sometimes there are some machines which generates noise, so we have to also take care of lubrication, maintenance. Okay, so this is regarding the noise level, and ideal condition is that the noise level should be less than 10 decibels. Again, work requiring higher level of skill, efficiency, the temperature should be reduced, right? So for higher level and skill and higher efficiency, the temperature should be minimum, or it has to be optimum. And what we can do is, if at all we want to increase the efficiency, so ventilation factor we have to increase by a factor of 2 to 3, and light level or illumination level may be raised by a factor up to 4. So generally these are the ideal working conditions. So that's it. Thank you.